APMVideo.com is on the air, and it's time for the two-time defending state champions in Arizona, the Brophy Broncos. And today, they'll be taking on a team out of Dallas, the Jesuit Dallas Club, and it should be some outstanding lacrosse. Brophy losing their first game of the season. It was an out-of-state game as they lose to Los Angeles, California's Loyola School by a final score of 10-7, but they are still undefeated and number one ranked in the state of Arizona. Brophy has been to more state championships.
Good evening and welcome to another live stream of Brophy's 2024 lacrosse season. This game is part of the Jesuit Classic that has been happening here at the Brophy Sports Complex starting last Friday, concluding tonight. My name is Matt McGinnis. I'm joined by Brian Patillo and Jeff Lowry from APN Video. Guys, I was not here on Friday. You just want to give us a little recap of how that game went? And Coach, were you here for some of the games on Saturday?
I did not see the games on Saturday. We were here for Friday during our broadcast. Unfortunately, cut short by a weather delay late in that game. But a good battle between two teams that I thought were playing at least pretty evenly matched. And unfortunately, the Broncos end up taking their first loss of the season. So they're going to have to do something today they've not had to do yet, and that's bounce back from a loss. We'll see how they adjust as we get into it.
And, you know, it's not a huge tournament field, the Classic, at this point. But so, of course, both teams do have one opponent in common, that being Loyola High School of Los Angeles. The Cubs won both of their games by similar goal differentials. They bested Brophy 10-7 on Friday night, and then Saturday they handed the Rangers a 7-4 loss. So my understanding is both of those games were close. For a goodly part of it, you know, for sure the first half, a bit into the third quarter, and then Loyola, you know, flipped into a different gear or something. And, well, here we go. We'll see how this turns out. For the Jesuit Classic, the Brophy Broncos against the Rangers of the Jesuit School of Dallas. And this is a face-up matchup. Caleb, their face-off player is about 60% so far in their six games this season. Deion James for the Broncos has a 73% clip of face-off wins. So this was going to be a good one. Caleb Caldwell,
junior. Be a good matchup to keep an eye on. We know how important Deion's been in wins for the Broncos. He'll have a tough matchup today. I will say, while we're getting underway here, just a reminder for our listeners, similar to the game Friday night, we are playing with a modified college rule set here. So we do have a shot clock going. We'll try and talk everyone through that as the game progresses. Something to keep an eye on. I don't think it was too impactful in Friday. I think it kept the game going up and down, but we didn't really have any major issues with it. So hopefully we'll have the same level of play tonight.
Both teams have about five commits that will play next year at the college level, so probably a good cursor for them. Nice save there by Ryan Peitzmeyer, coach.
Yeah, good save. Defender kind of gets beat a little bit. They were speed, not really a slide set up, so they'll want to kind of tighten that up defensively, but Ryan bails him out early in the game and keeps it a 0-0. Be interested to see what Brophy does offensively here. I thought one of the areas, quick one there, that they struggled with kind of initiating their offense and drawing a slide and getting into their whole rotation in that game Friday night. So we'll see what kind of adjustments Coach Pat Arbison and Coach Dan Davis drew up for this one here.
Yeah, there's something interesting about both of these goalies. They know each other. So Ryan Peitzmeier, the sophomore for the Broncos, knows Gabe James, this sophomore netminder for the Rangers. They've been playing together for the last 5 years in club. Now, for 3.5 of those years, Ryan was a deeple. But the last year and a half, of course, he's been between the pipes. So that's kind of the nature of lacrosse, a small world, Coach. But Western lacrosse, maybe, you know, a microcosm of even that.
Yeah, for sure. It's kind of cool to see that sort of cross-state connection and those kind of little rivalries that you can build up. So that's a neat little storyline there. I didn't know that going into tonight.
Well, the other thing, Coach, is we know you're a goalie from Tufts, a national championship in, what, 2011, Coach?
2010.
Okay. Yeah. Well, the head coach for the Rangers, that's a shot and a goal. Yeah. At the 9:23 mark. Number three, Keegan McGarity, a senior middie.
Kind of a replay of that same first play, just that sort of high wing dodge down the alley, and again, didn't really have a slide set up there from Brophy, so see their defense talk that over. I forget who it was, but I feel like that was an area that they had some struggles in earlier in the season against a different opponent also, so we'll have to make some adjustments and get some help. That time, Ryan not able to come up with the save on a good shot.
So I think Brophy with the draw control there after a solid 30 seconds of running around.
Never give up on that ground ball. Good save there on a Josh Busey shot.
You know, I was talking a moment ago, Coach, head coach of the Rangers, Chris Chouin, was a goalie at Syracuse. He has the 9th most saves in Syracuse history at 476 over his career. And then one of their assistant coaches up the goaltenders, Brandon Bannister. So I know you're have an affinity for all things goalkeeping.
It's a good goalie coaching staff there. So certain their players are taking good notes. There's a lot more saves than I had in my career.
So, Coach, to your point, the shot clock not really a factor just yet. And was that necessitated by Loyola having it in California, Coach?
You know, that's a good question. I didn't actually ask what was the thought behind it, but that would make sense. I think it did benefit the game overall, though. So it was, I think, a net positive for the experience of the game.
1-0. The Rangers are up, 7.5 minutes to go here in the first quarter. Noah Burdick with the fake and the shot.
Yeah, another save from the goalie there, off to a strong start in net.
We have 3 saves for him so far. Connor Rassis, really athletic, comes up with that ball. Tough kid. Stop the ball.
Yeah, it was a good ground ball there. Good clearing effort. Takes a few checks on the way for good measure.
A good crowd here this evening. It's a beautiful Monday in Central Phoenix.
Yeah, tough turnover there. Still haven't really been able to see the Broncos kind of get set up in their offense again. Come up about halfway through this first quarter. See how the defense responds here.
Coach Harbison said the keys for tonight's game: bounce back, be a great team, steal extra possessions in the ride, face-offs, extra ground balls on the offensive end of the field. And there you go.
It's a push.
You'd like to see more sideline engagement and enthusiasm. He would also like to see the defense be first to the ground balls. He said Loyola gained extra possessions by us not picking up the ball the first time. And as we know, it's like death, taxes, and ground balls win games, right, Coach?
Absolutely.
Axioms of life.
First time ground balls, that's a great point, too. We don't always put that nuance on it, but if you're able to... Ooh, good shot there.
Josh Busey, low right, to knot this thing up at the 5:22 mark.
Yeah, we tend to get to see a good angle on those Josh Busey right-hand shots when they're going this way, and he puts that one low and away and beats the goalie for the first goal for the Broncos. Good shot, good power, good placement. Just to tidy up that note, yeah, first-time ground balls, that makes a huge difference. Being able to get to it and get it up right away makes it a lot easier for you.
Wow. Whoa. Connor Rassis. I thought that trail check did him in, but he...
Yeah, somehow he holds on to it. I don't know. Maybe the other team wants a stick check there, but hopefully they don't call. Although I would say in that last game, there was another player on the other team. I would have called one on him. I think he made a couple plays where I was like, wow. But you know what? I have to say, I was in warm-ups walking on the field, I saw Connor warming up, taking a few extra shots. It looked like he was ready to let one go, and he... Those extra reps pay off there.
You know, he plays hockey as well. And in my experience, Coach, the wrist strength and the forearm strength of those guys, it's obviously has to be advanced. And Connor is, like I said, 6'3", 190, 195. He's a strong kid.
Yeah, good ball control with that long stick there. We see him be a menace on offense sometimes. So he continues to add an extra wrinkle to Brophy in the transition game.
It looked like that shot went in, Coach, but obviously not, it did not.
Yeah, it was outside. I think the goalie ended up kind of banging into the net and moved the net, which made it look like that, but not able to finish with the... quick stick.
Yeah, you know what? McGarity with his second goal of the game. I think he just said, if you're not going to challenge me, I will let it fly.
Yeah, I mean, he just steps in there and lets that go. Defense about a half second too late to get his stick on the hands there. Seems like he can be a real offensive threat, so somebody to keep an eye on.
So he has a pair of goals at the 9:23 mark and the 4:14 mark. Brophy scoring quickly at the 5:22 and 5:11 marks. So 4:14 to go here. It's tied up at 2. That is a win for the Rangers. I have it at 3-2. Draw faceoffs for the Broncos at this point. We knew it was going to be tight.
Yeah, we'll continue to watch that matchup as the game goes on here. We've seen Dion be able to sometimes make some adjustments on technique and strategy.
We see senior Patrick Fisher out there playing some D.
Good ball movement there by the Rangers. Brophy keeps up with them in their slide package rotation, forces that shot wide.
Nice defense there. Here comes Noah Burdick, the senior Hofstra commit.
Hey, let's watch the hold inside, bro.
We've used the term composure a little bit this year. Coach Harbison has to be clear, and sometimes you just got to maybe slow it down a little bit. Give your defense a break.
Yeah, you still want to, you know, as I mentioned, kind of starting your offense and establishing pace and momentum. They've not been able to do that. Oh, they're a little discombobulated there.
Shot and a goal, Rangers.
Yeah, I don't know what kind of happened.
Uncontested.
Yeah, well, they didn't have enough guys out there. I don't really know what happened, but some confusion, I think, on the sideline. And you know, Brophy sort of found themselves in almost a man down situation. So that's going to be a mental mistake. You don't want that happening there.
That was senior midi Sam Emery with the goal number 11, making the score 3-2 Rangers. If you're tuning in from Texas, we say hello here from the Sonoran Desert. We're a couple hours behind you as of yesterday with the time change. Arizona does not change.
It's a good save for Ryan there. I think he wanted that one. I don't know about that. I mean, we've got the away crowd certainly
has
some strong thoughts about the officiating so far here. I had no problem with that call. I mean, that one's not that close there. But Brophy will be the recipients of that 1 minute advantage from a slash. Looked like he kind of got him right on the leg there, so.
So just over 2 minutes to go here in the first quarter. 1 minute on that one.
Let's see what the extra man unit has.
Eric Wolfson.
And that's just Eric doing what he does best, that step down shot. I was thinking he was going to maybe bump it one more over, but that time he recognizes he's got a good opportunity and he beats the goalie. That will open up some of those looks. We've seen him like to feed the pipes in that man up 3-3 set, and when you can score one early there, now you're going to have everybody looking at you in that situation. So I have a feeling if they get another man up opportunity, we'll see him try to step down and look to feed it.
He is the points leader on the team because he has a almost equal number of goals and assists on the season, both in-state and against out-of-state competition. He's really shown his versatility and, court sense, I would say.
Yeah, I think his passing and his vision has gotten better and better every year, and I think it's really paid off where he's become kind of a dual threat in that regard as a midfielder. You don't really see that too often, so good weapon for Brophy to have.
Harrison Yu playing some stalwart D there against McGarity, which is smart as he already has two goals. another goal for Sam Emery at the 105 mark. So seven goals here so far in the first quarter with just over a minute to go. Keegan McGarity has a couple, as does Sam Emery. Both are seniors.
Yeah, getting some scoring production from the deeper part of their roster here.
The Rangers come up with that one. They have all been hotly contested.
Yeah, a lot of athleticism out there. I think both teams really playing hard and aggressive, showing a lot of speed. That's good to see.
So the Rangers are plenty of time on the shot clock, but the game clock is just under 20 seconds now. Hands-free shot.
I think that got deflected by Charlie, the sliding defenseman there. A little battle for the ground ball, unfortunately, goes the other way. Oh, wow.
Last second goal right on the doorstep there at the 1.6 second mark.
That's a tough one. I don't really know exactly what kind of happened there. It looked like he got checked and lost and bounced right to the Jesuit player kind of rolling around the crease. I think we hear Coach Harbison talking his defense. I'd like to see a little more body there. Got to not just play the ball when you have that little bit of time left. You got to check through the body. You take the guy out, especially when the ball goes on the ground. So a little bit of a missed opportunity for the Broncos there to clamp down.
So, after the first quarter, it is 5-3, care of that goal with 1.6 seconds left by the Rangers. So, this game has lived up to the billing of a couple of good teams going after it here in the Jesuit Classic.
Yeah, you take away that last goal, you know, you've only got a one-goal differential, so two teams battling pretty evenly matched right now.
We believe that goal was scored by sophomore Marshall Soroquaz. Marshall.
I'd like to see, as far as adjustments here, I think I'd like to see a little more aggression, I think, from the Brophy defense. I feel that right now they're kind of just sitting back. Uh-oh. What do we got going on over here? I think we've got an illegal stick.
So there is a flag down on the far side of the field. We have called over to the table. It does look like they're
sorting it out still.
Stick.
Yeah. Well, that could be a big swing in momentum. I don't know who was on, though. They threw two. I don't really know why they threw two. That seemed, unless they actually are calling two calls. I think they got one on each team here, it looks like.
Huh.
So, I don't know, maybe.
It's the same two Fogo's, Deion James for the Broncos, and Caleb Caldwell for the Rangers. I can't tell if they have different sticks or not.
Yeah, the well, typically, I think they have to serve it if it is them. So it looks like we've got two guys in the box. Josh Busey on our side. Number, I don't know the number for number 12. So that means we're going to be 5-on-5 for a little while here now.
So Deion James emerges with that ball. He has a slight advantage, I think, by one over the Rangers with face-off wins.
Yes, we did get confirmation. Each team with an illegal stick penalty, 1 minute. Those are unreleasable as well, too, so we will be 5-on-5 regardless of outcome here. That'll add a little wrinkle you don't always see
sure.
every game.
Yeah. So the Fogos did not have to serve it, Coach. That's interesting.
I don't know if it was on them. I think it's on the players who are in there now.
Okay.
They'll do a random stick check every quarter. It just so happened they found two of them that time.
Well, we are approaching April 15th, tax season. Yeah. You got to be aware of what might get you audited.
That is true. You got to know your stick. That could be a big thing.
Shot and a save.
That should be a shot clock, I think, after that. So it will be...
So 80-second shot clock, just like in men's college lacrosse. Successful clear.
Those penalties did get released now, so we're back to all even. No damage done on either side.
There could be psychological damage, Coach. You know,
well, I tell you what, everybody on the sideline is going to be checking their sticks now.
A shot and a goal, number 44, Grayson Kissock, a senior. At the 9:56 mark, so that's four different players now that have scored for Dallas Jesuit. That's always something to keep an eye on, you know, heading into this game, their top scorer. Beckett Foley had 18 goals. The next most goals was 9 by Will Fagan and Brody Hobbs. So Beckett has not scored yet. You would just expect your top scorer to get on the board right now.
Yeah, so, I mean, if you're the Rangers, you actually don't mind that, you know, to have a lead without contribution from your top scorer. And if you're a Brophy, you got to think what you're doing on that side's working well, but you got to pick it up for everybody else. And like I said, I'd like to see a little more energy and aggression on the defense there. Feels like on these slides, they're just not keeping sticks on hands and throwing some of those checks we see them do. So we'll see what they do there. Try to do a little invert look here. Which I like this. They've been successful with this in the past. I think they got away from this Friday night. But well defended.
Save, right, Coach?
I don't think so.
No.
I think that one was wide. And you know me, I usually give it to him, but that one, sometimes those big bounce shots are going to clearly go over. It's a little weird delayed start there.
30 seconds on the shot clock.
Oh, wow, what a save. It should reset the clock. It does, at least. So they will get a clock reset. There we go. Carter Barkley-White finds himself there on the crease. Isn't able to finish. We're going to get a timeout. Brophy, I believe.
So this will allow us to wrap up Coach Pat Harbison's keys to the game. It's timely. He says, be organized on offense, knowing the sets we want to run, and having patience, move the ball quickly. And lastly, Coach says, have fun. So they might be having a discussion along those lines.
Yeah, let's see what they draw up. I liked the invert look and starting to initiate the offense there. As I mentioned, I think one of their areas of improvement from that loss was going to be starting the offense with their dodge and drawing the defense into motion and then making sure that they are moving the ball and taking advantage of that motion. So let's see what they draw up here. This will be a good opportunity for them. They'll have a fresh shot clock. So far, I think we've seen a man-up goal. I think one in transition for sure. So still looking for that 6-on-6 offense to really take a hold, kind of get back some of that volume shooting we've seen from the Broncos as well, too.
Yeah, we've heard Coach Harbison say he likes to see shots in the 45 to 50 range. Right now, I have Brophy with about 7 in the first quarter and 6 so far here in the second, and there's 8:35 to go, so they've certainly picked up the pace a little bit. Wow, shot and a goal.
Go. That was Laird Miller.
That was assisted. It was pretty bang bang.
Yeah, nice little play design there. Kind of runs off the pick. Gets the defense looking at the ball and some nice backside off-ball movement there for Lair to find himself open in the crease there.
So that gets it within 2, 6-4. They're calling that one for the Rangers. Eight minutes to go here in the second quarter.
Hands.
Come on, Rangers! Strike one! Hold it back!
Here comes Harry Yu, the junior. He's got some wheels. Kind of doing what he's known for.
Yeah, they're going after him. You see they push it out adjacent, trying to put him under pressure there.
Thought for sure there would be a shot coming.
Yeah, I think everybody was kind of holding their breath there. But it sticks on hands. That's what I was kind of saying before.
Right.
You don't have to throw big checks when you get in those shooting areas. Just kind of stay right on their hands. Some pokes and lifts can disrupt that shot. You know, you throw your checks when you're outside, and you can move your feet still. When you're inside, just get on their hands and don't let go.
That was a good example of what you were just
saying,
Coach.
Yeah, exactly. Just kind of a little disruption there. Ends up kind of a little stick lift.
It's kind of like you don't need to sack the quarterback, but if you can hit his elbow, you know,
yeah,
same difference.
Exactly. You disrupt a pass. You can cause a turnover. Doesn't have to be a takeaway check every time.
Yep.
See if Brophy can return the favor of that same aggressive D. They had a good defensive possession last time, forcing a turnover. That one was. Well, that's going to be a slash, I imagine, here. Yeah, 1 minute. Thought it was a brush, but they're going to say caught him in the head. There was a nice sound on that one. Sometimes those are tough to argue.
Right. So Dane Helt will take a breather. A two-goal game here, 5:48 to go in the second quarter. Here come the Rangers of Dallas Jesuit. This is their seventh game of the year. This is Brophy's 12th. The Rangers have a 16-game schedule on their website. Brophy will play 22 games. So they're both right around midway through their respective seasons.
This ball push, I think, inside. Not the worst thing to happen when the ball's right in front of your goalie there. You don't want it, but
BC alternative.
Yeah, worse times to have a loose ball push than when the ball's right in front of your net. So I don't think anyone would be too upset with that.
That shot had some some heat on it. Let's go, Jackson. 5 minutes to go. The Rangers have the ball. I would put them at 60% possession, Coach.
Yeah, probably a little bit of an advantage, 60. But no overwhelming difference either way. I'm going to say that was deflected, so they'll stay it. That will be all even. Little quick little 1 second difference there slows it down a little bit, but we are back to all even. Defense there by Noah Burdick. This could be a shot clock situation here. You got about 15 seconds. The defense can hold on.
Wow. That's a bouncer from a good distance out.
And the trophy kind of gets caught in that. You know, high risk play, goes for the interception. The problem is when you miss it, you find yourself in a bad defensive spot and not having a slide ready, obviously, given that player can kind of step in and get a free shot, beats the shot clock with about 1 second left. So the Dallas team taking advantage of that decision.
Brody Hobbs gets on the board. He's a York College of Pennsylvania commit. So it's back to a three-goal difference with 4 minutes to go here. The Rangers come up with that face-off win. Again, very even so far, which is kind of what we were expecting.
Yeah, good battle there to get a timeout by the Rangers. I guess they called that first timeout also. I thought it was Brophy, but Looks like, according to the scoreboard.
So earlier we talked about, just momentarily, we just said Brody Hobbs is going to York. So let's take a quick look at where some of the other Rangers will be playing next year. We have three going to Suwanee, the University of the South, a D3 program in Tennessee. We have Ty Robertson, the senior attacker, Will Hooker, a senior defender, and Max Bensing, a senior middie. Beckett Foley will be a senior middie at Iona, a Division I program in New Rochelle, New York, a bit north of the city. Charles Schwartz, a defender, will be going to Benedictine in Atchison, Kansas. It's an NIAI program.
They're covering quite the geography there.
Yeah. You know.
It's quite the range.
He can't say we're not in Kansas anymore because he'll be there for maybe 4 years or so. On the Brophy side, we have a couple guys going to Hofstra. Noah Burdick, the talented LSM. Charlie McGinnis, the defender. We have another defender, Todd Baldiga, the junior, is going to Mercer to play for the Bears. Deion James will be taking his face-off prowess to Hampton University. And then Laird Miller will play for Division II powerhouse Rollins in Florida. They're currently near the top of the D2 rankings there. So we wish all of those players well and congratulate them on continuing their college lacrosse endeavors. Of course, some other players may still commit. Some other guys might play some club. It's all good, Coach. It's a fun game to keep going.
Yeah, a lot of opportunities for people to play at the next level, all different levels of commitment and academics, athletics, and club, and NCAA. A lot of options for everyone, and it's great to see people have those choices when they play.
I had the opportunity to speak with some parents from Dallas Jesuit, and they have Texas Christian University is a popular choice for some of their students, just like it is here at Brophy and Xavier, for that matter. It's such a shot clock violation. So there's a lot of good club lacrosse out there. It seems to be growing, but just from what I see in social media.
Yeah, I think we've seen that here firsthand, just with some of the programs from GCU, ASU. My brother's coaching at GCU now, and a lot of these club programs, they do try to run it like you would a regular varsity sport. So they take it seriously. It's not like they're just rolling the ball out there and playing. They've got practices and everything that goes along with building a program. They recruit.
Seeing Eric Wolfson reminds me that he'll be playing at Lafayette. He'll be a Leopard.
That was a really good slide by the defense there. He slid when Eric was rolling, and that's always what you kind of teach your defensemen, slide when the guy's back is turned. So as soon as Eric actually turned back around, defender was right in his face. So good package defense there.
Lafayette played at Colgate on Saturday. It was a cold, cold, rainy day in the Patriot League, so Eric is... will quickly figure out he's not in the Sonora Desert.
Yeah, that's gonna be a big difference for him. It's gonna take some adjusting, but he's a big kid. He could probably stay warm out there.
And he grew up in Philly.
There you go.
Connor Rassis with some good D there.
It's close. I was about to say really good communication and help. They kind of had two guys go to the ball there. Get a balance, about 11 seconds on the shot clock here.
So the Rangers have had two buzzer beaters so far, Coach, at the end of the first quarter and not too long ago with that shot clock. But it won't happen on this possession.
I don't know what actually was happening there. kind of, that was weird. It looked like Noah stopped, so he kind of heard a whistle or something. I don't know what the call was, though. Maybe just a little confusion on the shot clock, not realizing Noah picked it up kind of around the same time that the time expired. So it looks like one ref might have been calling just the shot clock violation at the same time. So I clean that up.
They've got it sorted out now.
Shot clock's off. There's only 33 seconds left here before halftime.
This would be a timeout by Brophy. It would be a much needed boost to their momentum to get on the board in the last few seconds here of the half.
Yeah, last time they came out of a timeout situation, they were able to draw up a play, kind of quick hitter. It only took them about 5 seconds to put one in the net. We'll see what they have again. They will have to start. There was a little, not confusion, just a note, just kind of rule variation. Normally we'll see them kind of call that timeout as soon as they get over the midfield line in the offensive zone. They do have to get into the box before they can call a timeout. So another little wrinkle to some rule changes here. But that will give the Broncos the ball with 21 and a half seconds.
So let's see what Coach Harbison and Dan Davis, the offensive coordinator, have concocted. So Laird should step in as quickly as possible, Coach?
Well, he won't have to worry about it now. No. With the shot clock rule. So that won't affect them. Okay. They don't have to step it in, but they just have to step in order to get the timeout. But this will be 10 seconds here. Not the option
Gabe,
you want
Gabe James,
for sure there.
Lead.
Yeah, he's going to get it. And this is going to... Oh, just got attacked by a bug over there here.
Now, Ryan threw his stick up in the air. Is that a penalty, Coach?
Yeah, it is technically, I think. I was getting attacked by a large moth.
Sure,
I let it have my eyes on the plane.
Your light flashed before your eyes, yeah.
But,
and you screamed like a girl.
I did. But... Yeah, that is technically, I do believe, a procedure call, but maybe they're going to say kind of the game is over.
Sure.
Halftime. So,
We'll be back in 9.5 minutes. Thanks so much for watching. We'll see you soon.
That will sound like we're done.
Yeah. That's
right. My bad.
Killer moth.
Surprise.
APNvideo.com is on the air, and it's time for the two-time defending state champions in Arizona, the Brophy Broncos. And today, they'll be taking on a team out of Dallas, the Jesuit Dallas Club, and it should be some outstanding lacrosse. Brophy losing their first game of the season. It was an out-of-state game, as they lose to Los Angeles, California's Loyola School by a final score of 10-7, but they are still undefeated and number one ranked in the state of Arizona. Brophy has been to more state championship games than any other organization in the Grand Canyon State, and their seven championships is tied with Chaparral's seven all-time. Pat Harbison and an outstanding coaching staff will try to pick up their winning ways on this Monday, March 11th. And Matt and Brian will have all the exciting play-by-play action. It's the Brophy Broncos on APNvideo.com.
We are back for the second half, the last half of the Jesuit Classic weekend here at the Brophy Sports Complex. It is 7-4. The Rangers of Dallas Jesuit against the Brophy Broncos.
Yeah, I was trying to figure out the name during halftime because I see it Dallas Jesuit. I see it Jesuit Dallas. Here we've got the Jesuit College Preparatory School of Dallas. So. So, regardless there, right
so,
away off that.
A lot of the Jesuit schools, so like a week from tonight, the Jesuit School of Portland. So they'll just shorten that to Portland Jesuit.
There you go.
Plays Dallas Jesuit in Texas. So as long as you get the city and the word Jesuit in there, I think you're okay.
Yeah, there we go. So let's see how the second half goes. Starts out right away with a good attempt by Dallas Jesuit there. Ryan Peitzmeier makes that save. That could have been a big momentum swing to start the second half there. It's a good feeling to start with a save.
You know, one thing I get a kick out of is both of these schools have the Jesuit mantra, if you will, shot and a goal. That's not it. that's not the Jesuit mantra, but it is for the moment there.
Yeah.
But ad majorem de gloriam, for the greater glory of God. So when my son was a freshman, it had ADMG, you know, on the Brophy jersey. Jesuit of Dallas has that too. And I said, you know, it stands for attack, midi, defense, goaltender. He's like, really? I'm like, no. But, you know, maybe at some religious level.
Yeah, maybe. You know, that's a good sign there.
Coach, who scored that?
I know
us,
we believe you.
Know?
That was number six.
Okay. Maddox Ranley.
Yeah, got a nice shot off there. Beats the goalie, so it's a good start if you're Brophy for the second half here. You get a nice defensive save from your goalie, and you come down scoring offense.
There's a flag down.
Yeah, I don't know if they think they're going to go offsides. Yeah, so can't really. I think it was offsides. Unless they called a slash. I guess we'll see for sure, but
that was about a 22-yard flag. It was an impressive trajectory on that one. Eli Friedman with the shot right into the stick.
Tries to get a little, the old jump shot. Extra velocity there. Probably wants to work on that placement a bit.
Gabe James, a very talented goalkeeper, just like his fellow sophomore, Ryan Peitzmeier, for the Broncos. Two guys that know each other well, as we mentioned earlier. They've been playing lacrosse together in the club level for 5 years.
Yeah, and here we go. We've got a little wrinkle here for Brophy and Dallas. They're using a strategy. They're going to lock off Eric Wolfson, so they're going to play 5-on-4. And that's how it's working. I was going to say, we see Brophy do that defensively. So that man up unit gets some practice doing that. They were prepared for it.
Laird Miller with the assist to Maddox Ranley, who scored at the 10:58 mark and now the 9:53 mark.
Good coaching and preparation there.
Two quick goals, Coach, in the first 2 minutes, more or less. So it tightens this game up considerably.
Yep, that's the start you want, and as I was just mentioning, nice composure. You get a little wrinkle thrown at you, but you're ready for it. You're prepared well, and the coaches coach, and the players execute.
That's a win for Caleb. Three flags down, a flag festival.
Yeah, everyone wanted to get a say in on calling that one. I think that will also be a slash. And he's kind of running through a few different players there.
So Deion James, I believe. Well, no, who's taking the knee there? Coach?
Yeah, I think that's Deion over there.
Is it? Okay.
Yeah. All right, well, we'll see what Dallas Jesuit can do now with their own opportunity here with the extra man unit. Okay, I like this here. Brophy kind of doing their own wrinkle with a little bit of extra pressure right away, which you don't see always. Whoa. I hit somebody in the helmet.
Wait, that, yes.
Yeah.
Well, Beckett Foley with his second goal on the night. Well-placed shot.
Yeah, and that's kind of the drawback. You put a little pressure. You're kind of running around a bit. You know, when you're man down, it's tough to extend. They get a little confused on who's supposed to slide out there. Harrison was kind of hanging out in that spot, but was covering inside. And number 12 found himself in a really good shooting lane. So
we have him with 12 goals on the season so far, coupled with 5 assists, 425 points in 6.5 games. So for a while there, the Fave Sox were just about even, but I think the Rangers now have a couple three to the good side on the docket.
Yeah, so far this second half, have maybe they've made some adjustments too. Let's see. Something to keep an eye on as the game goes on here. Those faceoffs are going to become more and more valuable.
So Foley's goal brings the difference back to two. So Noah Burdick playing some fastball there.
A hold, I think, on that trailer there. I think it kind of fell on top of him and delayed him from getting up.
So good defense there on the ride. Ta Baldiga stifles that attack. You know, you see a 6'6" player in front of you with a pole. You think twice, maybe, coach. But a shot and a goal there. Number 11, I believe. 41. Okay.
Half of it was right.
We're, again, about 80 yards from the action.
We're doing our best, yeah. Number 41.
Nicholas John, a senior.
Yeah, I think he kind of right place, right time again. That first check, I think, dislodged the ball, sort of found his way right to him. But as I always say, you got to get in the dirty areas and pick up those little ground balls, garbage goals.
So here's a change, coach, at the faceoff. Connor Rassis taking it.
Yeah, and this seems to be that B option that we see Brophy do sometimes.
So now with that three-goal differential, Harbison, Coach Harbison, calls a timeout at the 7:46 mark. Probably just wants to make sure everyone's on the same page to keep this at three and maybe tighten it up back to two.
Yeah, you get to take a breather and kind of talk through it. You know, if you're going to run something a little different with your face-off unit, I think there they kind of were a little confused with the substitution and was running in late. So I don't know if he felt he had to maybe call a timeout to avoid a penalty for or you know, an automatic turnover there for kind of a delay of game. So either way, it gives them a chance. Just get the whole team together talking it over. Three-goal differential.
All in all, there haven't been an inordinate amount of penalties. They're letting them play. Would you agree, Coach?
Yeah, I think everything's been pretty even. I think one of the early calls, you know, maybe you don't, but I felt there was one the other way too. So it's been consistent. That's really what you want. So good when you have two high-level teams playing at a high level. It's great when they can get out there and play.
You know, I had the chance to speak with some Jesuit parents before the game, and they said they believe their officiating here in Arizona is better than what they experience in Texas. So that's an anecdote.
That's a good sign, yeah.
And that's that scenario where everyone loves the backup quarterback, too.
Exactly, right, yeah. Or you get one game, you don't really know what the rest of them are like, but I do, you know, we talk about the refs, and I think they do the best they can out here.
So their officials get $100 per game for a varsity game here. Our officials get $84.
No, don't say that.
Okay.
Hopefully the
we'll strike that.
Union president's not listening.
Okay. But I think we get gas mileage here.
They do get reimbursement for travel.
And in Texas, gas is a nickel or something. Yeah. So, yeah.
Couple good saves from Ryan.
That was a wicked shot.
Yeah.
On the doorstep.
Got an invert look here.
with some good ball movement there. Results in a goal.
Yeah, that's tough to defend. They kind of get that drawn up like they do it. They push the ball one way, draw some attention, move it back, find the defenders out of place a little bit.
Okay. We have an assist from Ty Robertson to number... We don't have an 18. But it was assisted.
Yeah, good team offense there. And I think the Brophy defense has played well. We talked about it at halftime, and I think I'd like to see a little more kind of aggression and staying out of their hands. That time, though, you just end up in a tough spot when you're in that invert defense, and they move the ball that well.
So now it's the widest margin of the night. 10-6, 6 minutes to go here in the third quarter. The Rangers up over the Broncos.
That was a good play there by Eli, but great save by the Dallas goalie. Push. Yeah, that's a tough one, Tob. You're gonna learn that one. When you're twice the size of them, you get near his back, they're gonna fall over, and that goal's gonna go against you every time. You're a young kid at home. Whether you're, how tall is he?
He's six, right?
Whether you're that size or not, and you get into that situation, you got to go for a bottom hand lift. You got to stay away from his back. It's too easy for a player to just fall and get an easy loose ball push there.
And we've actually seen that called quite a bit this season, where if a smaller player is on the ground and a big player is within a mile, they seem to just call it every time.
Yeah, it's just the optics of it are hard to avoid, and players know that. You know, if you ask any of these littler guys out there playing, they'll maybe they won't always admit it, but they feel pressure on their back in that situation, fall down. Wow, that was a great save there. I think that was a save by Ryan, right? Unless that ball got checked loose. Yeah, that was good. So Ryan,
some solid defense played there.
Yeah, good play.
They're
tricking the stick into the objective.
There's a few technical pointers being shared.
I don't necessarily disagree with the crowd on that one, but I don't know if at this point in the game it's warranting that response. But you know, get passionate fans
for sure.
But there was an argument there. I thought that was kind of clean, but tough angle, and we're going to see that offense again. They're electing to go with the lock-off strategy on Eric Wolfson, so Brophy will have that 5-on-4 look, and then now they're going to sneak out of it potentially. So,
Gabe Davis again with the goalie ball there. So, you know, this is where Coach Harbison said they wanted to steal some possessions, and that's one thing to steal them, but you can't get them stolen from you either, right, Coach?
Yeah, and, you know, man-up opportunities are so important, and you don't necessarily want to give it up right away, especially if they're going to play that 5-on-4. It actually gives you an advantage if you're ready for it. I think you've got more space to work with. So I'd like to see a little more patience there, maybe.
Another great night for lacrosse here in Phoenix in March.
Oh, this weather's beautiful tonight.
Probably
this
in the high 60s around right now, maybe the low 80s around late afternoon. Let's go.
They've been trying to kill this penalty here, which they did, but now they're going to have a short shot clock to look at.
About 15 seconds to go on the shot clock. Swing and a miss there.
Nice ground ball there by Harrison Yu. Oh, they got numbers now.
So Matthew Lightman, Eli Friedman, Eric Wolfson, Josh Busey. I think that might be Ben Geist over there. And Laird Miller. See if they can put one in the net here to get a little closer.
Yeah, invert, look, got to move it and press now. About 20 seconds on the shot clock.
Nice pause turnover there. Henry Latta. Here come the Rangers.
Coming to the end of this third quarter here. About 80 seconds left.
50 on the shot clock, which could come into play.
Good backup there. Another situation, kind of go for that interception. High risk. That time they get bailed out by the wide shot. They got to go opposite. He's open.
Just a little too high.
Yeah, that was the look, though. He had him.
Right. I watched the Hofstra North Carolina game, and that was a move that North Carolina pulled off. That's the cross. You know, it's a little risky, right? You have to be pretty accurate.
Yeah, it's in the air for a while, too. That's the thing. So you got to make sure you leave him with enough time to catch it and not have somebody on his hands right away by the time you throw it. And that time there, good throw. And that shot got deflected, I think, on the way in.
25 seconds here. Shot and a goal. Rangers. I think that was number 13. Jackson Raymond, a senior.
Yeah, just in transition, fast break. You got to stop the ball. They don't stop the ball. He runs in and gets a clean shot. So Brophy going into this fourth quarter. We got 20 seconds left here. 5-goal differential. They're going to be forced to play a little more aggressive defensively. They're going to have to because they're going to need some turnovers here, particularly if the Dallas Jesuit team remains strong at the faceoff X.
I have them winning 4-2 here in this third quarter. So a goal with 1.8 seconds to go. So far, the Rangers have had goals with 1.8 seconds, 1.6, and about 1 second.
Yeah.
And those are demoralizing any way you slice it. And on the opposite side, it's huge momentum boost for the team that does it, Coach.
Yeah, that's tough. And it's just, you know, again, kind of guys in tight. You know, we talk about that big Brophy defense. I'd like to see a little more body checking in there when those guys are kind of catching the ball in tight.
So, here's the interesting part of this score, Coach. It's a 6-goal differential. Now, Brophy, about 3 weeks ago, was in this very same spot against Mater Dei. And they managed to come back and win that game by one, scoring with about a minute to go and then holding strong. So, obviously, if you're the Broncos, that's something you can refer to and say, listen, guys, it doesn't look great right now, but we came back and beat Matter Day. Conversely, of course, the Rangers have been pretty disciplined and methodical. They're probably saying, let's just keep this lead and maybe even step on the gas if we can.
Yeah, and it always helps when you have that one. You can think back. You know you're capable of doing it. Of course, every night's different, and you've got a new set of challenges here than they had with that modern day game, but you've got to keep the faith and just try to focus on the next goal. That's really what the mantra is, I'm sure, from the coaching staff right now. You're not thinking about how are you going to score 6 goals. You just need to be thinking about scoring the next one.
I think the faceoffs are tilting towards the Rangers. I think Brophy has around 7, and the Rangers have around 12 or 13.
Yeah, and this is going to be a big fourth quarter for that. You know you've got to come back here on, you need extra possessions, and they're going to get a little creative here. You can put 2 poles at the faceoff X here, so we've got Noah Burdick lining up at faceoff. Connor Rass is on the wing. They'll put a short stick down on the defensive side in order to do that. So a little coaching move, trying to shift the balance.
Junior Henry Latta taking the win there for the Rangers.
Yeah, and here, well, let's see, you know, we're getting to this fourth quarter here. You do have the shot clock for your advantage, too, so that will help Brophy in terms of comeback potential. We'll take away some of the opportunity to stall on offense, but I imagine they're going to have to start sliding early, maybe taking some risks.
I mean, yeah, 80 seconds is almost a minute and a half.
That's
still a good chunk of time.
You've still got to play defense here, and oh, no.
McGinnis with a deflection there. He's open.
Move it.
That was just in time.
Oh. Gotta have somebody telling him there's a guy on him there.
I learned the term Oya maybe 4 or 5 years ago on your arse. I guess.
Oh, there you go. That makes sense.
Would be a family-friendly way to say that. But that's what you got to scream. The bench has to
yell.
Yeah,
there you go. That has to be. You got to help your team out. It's going to be a tough turnover there, too. This is the possessions become all more important now. Every time you've got that ball, you know, you don't mind not scoring, but you want to at least be threatening and make the defense have to work for it.
So we see Patrick Fisher, the senior, in. I think Dane Helt, the sophomore, is in on D. Ball knocked down there.
Yeah, good deflection.
Nice work, Taub. Caused that turnover. 10 minutes to go here. Still a 6-goal game.
That's a tough one there, too. Again, let's see if they elect to kind of do a little shutoff here and let Charlie kind of play some defense here. They are kind of pushing out adjacent, so it's a little bit more of that aggression. They skip it, but I think you'll see that more. Try to get an opportunity for your pole to take the ball away.
.55 on the shot clock. Nice save there.
Yeah, that was going low and away. That was good shot placement. I think Ryan just gets the kick save out on that one.
Flips it over to Patrick Fisher. Patrick's headed to Notre Dame University in the fall. A little too much hot sauce on that one.
Yeah, that's tough. Yeah, we usually see Eric throw those well, but he's kind of in a tough speed. He's running to the defender. It just makes it a difficult play there.
When you're trying to make up such a deficit, the pressure just seems to ratchet up.
Yeah, and that's, I mentioned it before, you don't necessarily, you need every possession, but if you get a good shot off, you feel a little more confident here, and that's kind of two times now they haven't even been able to get a look at the cage. So that's going to hurt your momentum and your confidence when you really need it most.
Harry was gaining on him, but a nice ground ball there.
Yeah, and I think that was a good save by Ryan. They reset the shot clock, so I'm going to assume he got a save there. It was a little cluttered in front.
So the Rangers have made some lineup changes as well. Noah Burdick shuts that down.
Good defense here. Dallas is going to run the clock, but you're...
Shot with 10 seconds to go there on the shot clock. I was going to say, yeah, if they scored like a fourth goal
close
with under a second to go, Hail Mary or something.
Yeah, and I think that was Noah actually playing defense there too. Looked like he was kind of behind him, but he throws a good check and stays on his hands and forces a real errant shot there.
Six and a half minutes to go here in the fourth quarter.
Still plenty of time here. No reason to rush it. You can stay in your offense here. We talked about how the last couple times you haven't even gotten a shot off, so take your time. Have your confidence still. Don't go out of the game you're playing.
Nice ground ball there. Carter Fitzgerald.
There you go. You get a shot on net. Good save by the goalie there. Got a piece of that one, it sounded like. But you're starting to put a little pressure on. So actually, I guess they did not get a shot on net because the clock did not reset. So sorry, goalie. That time I tried to give you a save, but I can't get away with it as much when there's a shot clock,
Right, right. Keeping you honest, coach.
Yeah. Got 2 minutes on you. One more. Move it.
Shot clock.
That's going to be a good play in the corner. Smart play.
Reminds me of when these boys play box lacrosse and throw in the corner like
yeah,
that.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it's a smart little play. And I think that was Eric. We know he's got a good history playing box lacrosse.
For sure.
And you want to at least make it a little harder for him. And that's tough that you don't come away with a goal. Well, that worked out there well. But you had a nice possession. You get a little momentum going here. Plenty of time still.
I don't know about that, coach. It's 5 minutes. That doesn't strike me as plenty of time to score six goals when we've only scored six goals
well, you
in
just,
the first.
Like I say, you guys worry about the next one. You just got to get one.
All right, coach.
But yes, no, I think in an unbiased way, yeah, you've still got a challenge, but you don't need to be doing anything too crazy here. Let's see how this goes. Maybe next time, though, might be different. You might have to start doing some crazy things.
Some good D by the Rangers.
Yeah, that's tough. That one's going to...
I think that was intended for Eric.
Yeah, that was a little bit of a weird weird it play.
Seemed like a patented time for Eric's step down.
Yeah. Well, I will take it back. I'll say now you are going to be in a little bit of challenge from a time standpoint. Defensively, you've got to be thinking play and try to cause some turnovers here.
Shot and a goal. It's actually the first of the fourth quarter coming with under 4 minutes to go.
Yeah, and that's going to be... That's going to be a little bit of a exclamation point there.
We did not catch a number on that, but screaming down the alley. I would have bet the ranch he was shooting, Coach.
Yeah.
Six.
Play the double right there. Good timeout. Yeah. Good timeout. Now it's not looking so good.
No. Let's talk a little bit about the next games for these two programs. So for the Rangers, they'll head back to Texas for an away game at Coppell, Texas, this Friday. And then, as we mentioned earlier, 1 week from tonight, they will host Jesuit Portland. And that team is currently ranked number 9 in the West. Brophy is currently ranked number 10 in the West.
I believe that Loyola team was...
7th.
They were ranked as well, too. Yeah.
So, some talented teams here in the Jesuit Classic. Brophy will play another talented Texas team this Thursday. The Episcopal School of Dallas will be in town right back here at the Graham Family Sports Complex. And they are ranked number 9 in the South by USA Lacrosse. So, iron sharpens iron. That's why Coach Harbison schedules these tough teams from out of state. Because it's how you get better, right? How you learn.
You get opportunities to play against some great competition, and it's kind of spring break week in the ALL here. I think there's only 2 ALL varsity games the rest of the week, so it's most teams kind of get some time off here and are kind of resting, recovering, and Brophy using this time to have a little midseason kind of gauntlet of games. With the hopes that that's going to help prepare them for the postseason later on.
Yeah, their next league game will be against, they'll be up at Notre Dame next Friday for their first game against Notre Dame.
Yeah, it's going to be a good one. Notre Dame undefeated so far.
Good job, 3 minutes to go in this one, 7 goals difference.
Yeah, that was a good ride after Brophy kind of forced that turnover. That really got the momentum going for the away team there and helps give you an opportunity to run off more clock.
Yep. Andrew Muntz, the sophomore, is seeing some action on defense. Charlie McGinnis right now playing some D. Justin Anderson, number 17, forcing the issue. And surprise, surprise, Harry comes
look
up
at that,
with it.
Yeah, out of all that craziness. And well, under 2 minutes, they got to move it.
There.
Yeah, that ball squirts out of Josh Busey's stick as he went for that ground ball. And that will likely seal it here.
Yeah. 90 seconds in the game, 80 seconds on the shot clock. Goalie is out, making some clears.
Oh, I think he stepped out there on that end line. So,
wow. It's a souvenir.
Yeah.
That pass was a little too much arc.
Yeah, a little one got away from him there.
So the Rangers will have the ball with 1 minute to go. And a fresh shot clock is so that's not a factor.
Yeah, it looks like they will be content to kind of run this out here. Maybe one little look, depending on how aggressive Brophy gets here.
Seconds to go. So that will pretty much do it for tonight's game. Thank you so much for watching. It's now official. Rangers win 13-6 in this year's edition of the Jesuit Classic. So thank you to the Rangers for coming out, as well as the Loyola High School of Los Angeles. We wish you safe travels back to Texas and good luck for the rest of your season. And speaking of Texas, as we mentioned, the Episcopal School of Dallas will be here on Thursday right here at the Brophy Sports Complex for our next APN video broadcast. So for Brian Patillo and Jeff Lowry, I say thank you and have a good night.